Jacob Sager Weinstein joins us from Great Britain. Well, he's not from Great Britain. He's from Washington, D.C. He now lives in Great Britain. He is an award-winning comedy writer and has written for McSweeney's, The New Republic, The Onion. He's the author of How Not to Kill Your Baby. His latest book is Lyric McKerrigan, Secret Librarian. And he's been covering Brexit for us. Hello there, sir.
Hello. I think it's always important to start by noting, although I am not from Britain, I am a joint citizen. So anything I say must be right because I am British.
You are British. Yes, you are.
Yes.
And you think Yiddish. You have the best of both worlds. You dress.
Exactly.
Have you tried dressing Yiddish and thinking British?
I haven't, but I will work on that.
That's growing up. That's what I was told to do. Think Yiddish, dress British, and everything will be all right. I want to ask you about Brexit in a second, but we're coming up on the end of October. Do you have fall in London? Do you have the leaves? Do you paint the leaves the way we do here?
I'm sorry, we don't have fall. We have autumn.
Oh, autumn. I'm sorry.
Yes, very, very different. We do, yeah. Actually, there's been some beautiful fall foliage.
And what colors do they have in Great Britain? Because we have like yellow, blood red, orange. What do you
have? We have chrysanthemum and white.
Is it as colorful? Because I do know that we have peepers going through Vermont. Supposedly Vermont and parts of Massachusetts are the most... Peepers are people who come from all over the world to see the leaves. I am told that in New England, the foliage is spectacularly beautiful and unique.
Yes. Yeah. No, it is not as beautiful here as it is in New England. But it is lovely. And we make up for the lack of fiery foliage by the fact that it gets dark at 4 p.m. So it's just as depressing, but slightly less beautiful.
Why don't they call it Old England? That'll be, huh?
We'll work on that. That's you know, you Americans with your sense of branding, you always have something to teach us. So I appreciate that.
Do you celebrate Halloween?
We do. So like me, Halloween is sort of an American import here in Britain. It has become much bigger in areas where there are American expats. It's still not as universally celebrated. So when I take my kids out trick or treating, we can't knock on every door. We sort of look for doors with the Halloween decorations, cobwebs. The scariest thing I saw, somebody had set out a jack-o'-lantern in their front yard, and instead of carving a face on it, they had just carved the name Trump. Mm. That was definitely the most frightening jack-o'-lantern in all of Britain.
Well, he is pumpkin-faced, isn't he? Same color.
That's true. That's true.
And it's a American tradition, Halloween? I thought it came to us from... I don't know, Ireland or something, or Gaelic.
Yeah, there is some sort of Irish tradition where I believe you carved out a turnip and put a candle in it. Mm. But that has morphed into pumpkins in the New World.
I see. All right. And what are you going as for Halloween?
I am going as a relieved member of the European Union because October 31st was supposed to be the date on which Britain left the EU. And indeed, Boris Johnson won the office of prime minister mainly because of his promises to the Tories that do or die, come hell or high water, Britain would be leaving on October 31st. And when the question of an extension came up, he said he would rather be dead in a ditch than have an extension. So as of today, the EU has granted an extension. So this is actually one of the nice things that we do have some lovely fall leaves to coat that ditch that Boris Johnson has sworn he will be dying in.
How popular is Boris Johnson?
Boy, it's so hard to tell. So I've seen lots of footage of him out on the street being accosted angrily by British citizens. You know, I'm in London and everybody I know detests him, but that's sort of like asking somebody from New York how popular Donald Trump is. I have no idea what life is like outside my bubble. I've seen surveys that show the Tories aren't doing great in polls. But interestingly, polling here is not as extensive and as reliable as it is in the U.S., so it's always hard to know what to make of it.
They've extended the Brexit until the 31st of January, and there's also supposed to be an election, but there will be no referendum on whether or not to remain.
That's exactly right. As far as anybody knows, and, you know, when I moved to Britain 17 years ago, the aspect of politics here that was hardest for me to wrap my head around was this idea that you do not have a fixed date every X number of years when you have an election. An election happens more or less when Parliament decides they want one. A few years ago, there was something called the Fixed Term Parliament Act in 2011, which changed slightly how, or actually in some way changed fundamentally, how elections get called, but it still could happen at any time, and there may be one coming up in December.
There may be an election coming up.
There may be. So what it used to be for centuries is that, so the prime minister serves with the confidence of Parliament. He is essentially simply somebody who has the confidence of Parliament. That's how his role is defined. So an explicit vote of no confidence sacks him, or traditionally would cause a new election. There were also certain things that were considered equivalent to a vote of no confidence. So if he lost a vote on the Queen's speech, which we talked about last time we spoke, that would trigger a new election. In 2011, they changed the law so that the only way a new election can be called is if there's a two-thirds vote in Parliament to trigger one, or if there's a majority vote in Parliament for that says of no confidence, followed by 14 days of trying to get a new government together that fails.
Okay. What's going on with Northern Ireland? I've read that Northern Ireland could end up remaining in the EU.
Yes, and your tone of voice is exactly the tone of voice of most people in Britain, and especially the members of the DUP, which is the Democratic Unionist Party. I think, by the way, I added that oi in. That oi is not
in power. He formed a coalition with
them.
That's
right. And as their name suggests, their key platform, their very reason for existence, is keeping the union between Northern Ireland and the rest of Great Britain strong. So any Brexit deal that draws a line between Northern Ireland and Great Britain is going to piss off the DUP something royal, and indeed it has. So Johnson's latest deal has very clearly lost the support of the DUP. But part of the whole problem for Brexit, why it has been an impossible circle to square, is that you have a couple of options, and none of them are great. So you have on one geographic island, you have Ireland, which is its own country that is part of the EU, and Northern Ireland, which is part of Great
Britain. Yes. All right, slow down for 1 second. Ireland is not part of the Commonwealth.
I believe you are correct, yes. It is part of the EU. It is not part of Great Britain. I don't think it's part of the Commonwealth, but I always get confused as to what is. But I believe you're right.
Right. And then there's correct. Northern Ireland, which is made up of mostly Protestants, where the troubles have been. They are, they want to be part of the union.
Part of Great Britain. That's correct. And by the way, and you're absolutely right, by the way, just to clarify, the Ireland is not part of the Commonwealth. But yes, so Northern Ireland is one of the constituent countries of Great Britain. So it's always a little confusing, but the Great Britain is a country that is made up of several countries. The best analogy is to think of them like states in the United States, although I know that's not quite the same. But so Northern Ireland, England, Scotland, and Wales are the countries that make up the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland.
Mm-hmm. So if there is a Brexit, Northern Ireland would remain in the EU, which means that they wouldn't have to pay any tariffs.
Well, it depends on part of what's so confusing about Brexit is that the referendum that people voted for just said, should we leave the EU? It never said how. So if Britain leaves the EU, you have two options for Northern Ireland. Either Northern Ireland also leaves the EU, in which case you then have to put up this hard physical border between the country of Ireland and the Good Friday Peace Accords that ended the trouble was predicated on the idea of complete free movement between Northern Ireland and Ireland. So you basically are tearing up, you draw a border and you tear up this peace treaty that ended decades of sectarian violence, or you don't draw the border there, in which case you have to draw the border somewhere because otherwise we haven't left the EU. So you do what Boris Johnson has proposed, which essentially you draw the border in the water between Northern Ireland and the islands of Britain, of England with and Scotland and Wales. But the problem with that is that then Northern Ireland is suddenly very separate from the rest of Great Britain, which goes against the whole existence of this unionist party, the DUP, which has been until now one of Johnson's main supports.
And Northern Ireland's economy is doing pretty well for the first
time. It turns out that peace is actually pretty good for the economy. So either of your options, either you seal yourself off from the EU and you restart the troubles, or you seal yourself off from the UK, neither of those are great. If I were Northern Ireland, I would be just as happy to sort of essentially stay in the EU. But I understand this is a very complex issue with very deep and complex loyalties that, you know, your American accented middle-aged Jew who lives in London probably does not feel as passionately.
If they were to hold a vote now, what would the outcome be on Brexit?
Well, so if it were just a vote on Brexit.
I mean, the impression I get, this is what I get, and you tell me if I'm wrong. There's an allegiance to the democratic process. A lot of people are saying, well, you know, Brexit may have been a mistake, but the people have spoken. We might as well go through with that. I mean, I'm getting that from reading what the Lib Dems, is it the Lib Dems?
Right.
That the Lib Dems are kind of like, well, we're not for Brexit, but the people have spoken. As I understand it, the Labour Party, Jeremy Corbyn, has been kind of squirrely on this.
You're correct that the Lib Dems is the name of the party. That's actually not their position. The Lib Dems, of the three major parties, has been the only gung-ho, revoke Brexit, stay in the EU party. So after a lot of waffling, and you're absolutely right that Labour has waffled a lot, but they have finally sort of settled down into saying we need a second referendum. They haven't yet.
Lib Dems
Lib Dems say, well, we prefer just to revoke Article 50 and stay in the EU. So Article 50 is what we passed to leave the EU, or what we invoked to leave the EU. So the Lib Dem position is, forget about Brexit, just cut off the debate, stay in the EU and move on. The Labour position is actually, let's have another referendum between some actual deal, some actual Brexit deal on the table and remaining. The Tory position is, let's just get out even without a deal.
Yeah, and the Tory position, I always thought, was we didn't think this would happen. Like Cameron, it started with Cameron, who was prime minister when he introduced the vote. But didn't he do this to just shut up the far-right members of his own
party? Yes, that is exactly right. And it's clearly worked beautifully. That's why the far-right is dead all across the globe, and Britain is entering a new era of liberal prosperity.
So if they had the vote now, what would happen?
Well, all the polls I've seen, and again, I insert that previous caveat about the unreliability of polling in Britain, but suggests that Remain would now win. And I think that's for a few reasons. I think people are tired of Brexit. I think some percentage of the population has come to realize they were lied to and have changed their mind. But honestly, part of it is just that the older you are, the more likely you are to vote for Brexit. So it's very clear that, to put that differently, the fewer years of life you have left, the more likely you are to say, screw it, let's just get out of here. Whereas if you actually have a future to care about, you're more likely to want to have the option of living and working in the EU. And in the time since that referendum, a certain percentage of the leave vote has died, and a certain percentage of people who were too young to vote in the previous referendum have now aged to the point where they can vote, and they're much more likely to vote remain. So just demographic factors alone make it likely that remain would win out in another referendum, but who knows? It's also, you know, every prediction I've personally made for the past few years has been wrong. So that's a promise I make to your podcast listeners.
Right. It's a self-inflicted wound, but is it a wound? Is the economy suffering right
now?
Yes,
there has generally been a slowdown in the economy. Even if today we vote to revoke Brexit and stay in the EU, some percentage of businesses have already started the process and moved elsewhere within the EU. I think that a lot of the problems are somewhat reversible if we decide to stay, but the much damage has been done.
Okay. And the people take to the streets. We see it all over the world. Not here in the United States so much.
Well,
people have been protesting.
Yes. Yeah, absolutely. Right? So I went to a march for the people's vote, which was a huge march. I think about 1 million people through London demanding a second referendum. And I, you know, it was probably the most British moment there was when it started to rain halfway through. And people began cheering. And as far as I could tell, we were just cheering for the fact that we were marching in the rain. And I've never felt more British than at that moment. Hmm.
And any pro-Brexit marches?
Yeah. I mean, you know, a couple months ago, Nigel Farage started a pro-Brexit march. And in an example of really beautiful symbolism, he sort of started the march and then deserted it and let the handful of people doing it struggle their way to London on their own. There just doesn't seem to be the same sort of passion, at least in terms of organized, peaceful protest on the Leave side. I feel like the Leave side, the people who really care about it, just write threatening letters to their MPs instead of public protest.
And you have great protest signs.
We do. And so I had a fun time sort of looking at the various ones. For a while, I was marching behind a group from Stratford, which had a sign there that had Shakespeare sort of surrounded by the EU flag. And I felt very sophisticated for that. Then I marched right after that. I sort of shifted in the parade and found myself behind somebody holding a much rougher sign written on the back of a whole wheat cereal box that said simply "flush the turd," and I thought of you, Felda, when I saw that. I was like, "I'm going to remember that one. Felda will appreciate that one."
And they're peaceful,
yeah,
right?
It was very peaceful.
No,
I saw no violence. I saw another sign that again very British. It said, "Clearly, tutting loudly doesn't work, so I'm here."
And finally,
one more that again made me think of you. This is from some marchers from Cornwall, and I want to apologize to your extensive Cornish audience because I'm sure I'm gonna say this wrong.
Prince Charles listens and doesn't he run Cornwall? Doesn't he have the contract for that town?
I did not know that. I would not be surprised. But so the Cornwall contingent had a sign that said "Bram orth Bretmas," which apparently is a traditional Cornish curse, and it means a fart to Brexit.
Ah, as only the British can do.
Yes.
Before you go, we always think the British follow America better than the Americans do. Do you follow our elections? Now, or are you all caught up in your own?
No, I have been following them. Oh, but I'm sorry. This is actually something interesting that a couple of the signs there, part of the motivation for opposing Brexit is this fear that if we leave the EU, we'll be forced to draw closer to Trump. So a number of the signs were pictures of Trump, or there's like a picture of Trump eating up the NHS, the National Health Service. There's this fear that if we leave the EU, we're opening up the British economy to like Trump coming in and taking over. So. We hate him just as much as you do.
Yeah. They do wear us down, don't they? These people like Boris Johnson and Donald Trump, that's their danger, is they don't stop. They're like dogs. They just
And
keep
that is
going.
I feel like that is I'm still ambivalent about this whole thing where there's no fixed election, but that is one of the strong points of this parliamentary system that in theory, if Johnson overplays his hand, he could be gone in a week. That you sort of don't need the drama and complexity of impeachment. You just have an election and he's gone.
Yeah, yeah. Well, Jacob Sager Weinstein is an award-winning comedy writer, and he is the author of How Not to Kill Your Baby, the Hyacinth series. It's a middle grade fantasy. When you say middle grade, that's for
school
children.
Basically like younger than teens and older than picture books.
Yeah, but when, you know, when I hear middle grade fantasy, it's like, that's okay. It's not top notch. It's middle grade writing. It's a middle grade fantasy trilogy about the enchanted rivers underneath the city of London. What do they call that thing that's floating around down there? It's spread to New York. We talk about it. Not the blob.
The Fatberg.
What is it? The Fatberg. Yeah, we'll talk about that next week. And you could buy his new book, Lyric McKerrigan's Secret Librarian, with art by Vera Brosco. Who's Vera Brosco?
She's fantastic. She's an Eisner-winning Caldecott honoree, and she is absolutely fantastic. Honestly, forget about my writing. You should buy the book just for her art.
Fantastic. Stand the line for 1 second, Jacob Sager Weinstein.